Hi students, welcome to EPG Paathshala project. Let me introduce myself. I'm Dr. Bindu B, working as assistant professor in Martyrfless Training College, Thiruvananthapuram, Kerala. Today, we are going to discuss about the economic perspectives of education. Let me start the module on human development and education. The main objectives of this module are, first, to explain and define the concept of human development. Second, to explain and define the pillars of human development. Third, to gain insight into the relation between human development and economic growth. Fourth, to understand the components of human development. And finally, to elaborate the concept of human development index. See students, we all are interested in seeking education. There may be particular reasons for that also. The reasons prompting this quest for education may be acquisition of better knowledge and understanding, better earnings, higher status in the society, better living condition, and so on. There may be n number of reasons. We know very well that our development depends upon the education that we have acquired. One peculiarity of development is that it is not confined to ourselves, but will pass on to the society and then to the nation. That is why our governments are spending huge amount of money for education. Education is the most important element for growth and prosperity of a country. The wealth of a nation depends on how effectively its young minds are trained and educated to take up the challenge of the future. In this context, human development is essential for the development of a country. For example, take the case of our country. India is in the process of transforming itself into a developed nation by 2020. Yet we have 350 million people who need literacy and many more who have to acquire employable skills to suit the emerging modern India and the world. Education is considered as the key instrument for realizing human development. You may be familiar with the different types of education. There are basically three types of education, namely formal, informal, and non-formal. Let us see one by one. Formal. Formal education is the education that occurs in a formal setting known as school. Formal education is given in a school by a teacher formally trained and certified in the field of education. Curricular content and method of administration are clearly defined by law and policy in a school setting. The curricular content of formal education covers virtually all areas of human activity. Formal education is associated with compulsory curricular activities and an adherence to time schedules. Primary, secondary, and tertiary schools provide formal education. The second type is the informal education. It is the education acquired through interpersonal associations. Informal educations can be acquired from family relationship, social organizations, religious associations, and peer groups. In these relationships, teaching and learning may or may not be conscious and deliberate. The curriculum of informal education is often determined by prevailing circumstances. The last one is the non-formal education. Non-formal education is the education given in non-formal settings, such as on-the-job training or workshop, artisans workshops, and the education provided in training centers. The administrator of a non-formal education institution may or may not have a formal education depending on the content of the program they administer. A high level of mastery of the skill to be transmitted is usually a major qualification. For instance, in a skill acquisition program, the instructional emphasis is on equipping the learner with the basics of the specific skill, whereas in a literacy program, the emphasis is on literacy and numeracy, and the services of a trained teacher are necessary for effective teaching and learning. Non-formal education is designed for people who cannot tolerate the rigidity of formal education or who for one reason or the other miss the opportunity for basic formal education. The curriculum of non-formal education is therefore designed to suit the learning needs of this category of learners. All these different types of education help in the development of the individual in one way or the other. Education should help in the complete development of the man. Students, you may be remembering Gandhiji's definition, which is very much significant in this regard. According to Gandhiji, Education means an all-round drawing out of the best in child and man, body, mind and spirit. Now you can understand what it means by complete development. UNESCO has identified the four pillars of education as: first, learning to know; second, learning to do; learning to live; and learning to be. Look at the first one, that is learning to know, which implies learning how to learn by developing one's concentration, memory skills and ability to think. Education must promote such qualities since every individual has hidden talents such as memory, reasoning, imagination, physical ability, aesthetic sense, aptitude to communication, etc. Second is the concept of learning to do. It implies that learning must transform certified skills into personal competence. It is assessed by looking at a mix of skills and talents, social behavior, personal initiative, and a willingness to work. They are often referred to as interpersonal skills of people skills by employers. Knowledge, along with other qualities like communication, team building, and problem solving skills, is most demanded by the service sector these days. Personal competence include life skills like social behavior, personal initiatives, willingness to take risk, communication skills, problem solving skills, adaptability, social responsibility, leadership skills, etc. Then we'll pass on to the third concept, that is learning to live, which means education should help in inculcating a spirit of empathy in students so that it can have a positive effect on their behavior throughout their lives. Understanding each other, resolving conflicts through dialogue and discussion should be the essential tools of present-day education. We know the people around the world are not unique. There are differences with regard to color, race, language, custom, practices, etc. So what we need is that people of the world should accept their differences, but start working on the basis of their commonalities for the survival of humankind, which should result in the development of non-violence, cooperation, selfless attitude, developing human values, accepting human diversity, and instill an awareness of the similarities and interdependence of all people. And finally, the last one is learning to be, which implies that the aim of development is the complete fulfillment of man and his development in a holistic way as an individual, member of a family and community, and as a responsible citizen. According to Alvin Toffler, the illiterate of 21st century will not be those who cannot read or write, but those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. This implies that all people should receive in their childhood and youth an education that equips them to develop their own independent, critical way of thinking and judgment so that they can make up their own minds on the best courses of action in the different circumstances in their lives. Dear students, it is essential in this context to know about the theoretical knowledge of human development. Human development is a well-being concept within a field of international development. United Nations Development Program, that is UNDP, defines human development as the process of enlarging people's choices, that is, choices that allows them to lead a long and healthy life, to be educated, to enjoy a decent standard of living, as well as political freedom. Other guaranteed human rights and various ingredients of self-respect. The concept of human development was first laid out by the famous economist and Nobel laureate, Professor Amartya Sen, and expanded upon by Martha Nussbaum, Sabina Alkre, Ingrid Robbins, and others. According to Professor Amartya Sen, human development is much more associated with the concept of human capabilities. In his opinion, the core of human well-being is freedom of choice by enhancing people's capabilities for attaining higher standards of health, knowledge, self-respect, and ability to participate in the community life. The standard of living of a society should not be judged by gross national product per capita and the supply of particular good, but by people's capabilities. That is, what a person can or cannot do, can or cannot be. In the words of Amartya Sen, the goal of development is the promotion and expansion of valuable capabilities. there are different dimensions to the human development which can be related to life, knowledge, work and play, relationship, spirituality, participation, inner peace, appreciation of beauty, harmony with non-human world, etc. The concept of individual development is based on capability, and capability is an all-round human quality. In today's world of competition, capability has become the buzzword. Opportunities are always based on the capability of a person. What does it mean by capability? Capability is an integration of knowledge, skills, personal qualities, and understanding used appropriately and effectively, not just in familiar and highly focused specialist contests, but in response to new and changing circumstances. Capability can be observed when we see people with justified confidence in their ability to, first, to take effective and appropriate actions and decisions, explain what they are about, live and work effectively with others, and continue to learn from their experiences as individuals and in association with others in a diverse and changing society. Capability is a broader concept than that of competence. Competence is primarily about the ability to perform effectively, concerned largely with the here and now. Capability embraces competence, but is also forward-looking concerned with the realization of potential. Now, it is the education for the development of human capabilities aims at different things. Let's see what they are. Development of inborn potentialities. Education helps the child to develop the inborn potentialities of child, providing scope to develop in certain aspects. Let us see what they are. First one is behavior modification. As we know, education helps to modify the past behavior through learning and through different agencies of education. Next, there is harmonious development. Education aims at the all-round development of child that can be physical, mental, social, emotional, and spiritual. Then definitely it will prepare the individual for the future. After completion of education, the child can earn its livelihood, getting proper education, which has productivity. The education should be imparted according to their own interest of the child. And fourth one, it is a sure concept that it will lead to personality development. The whole personality of the child is developed physically, intellectually, morally, socially, aesthetically, and spiritually. He is recognized in the society. The next one is that is helping for adjustability. Man differs from beast. Man has reasoning and thinking power. Man tries his best to adjust with his own environment through education. And again, development of social and moral values are there, which means that is our society is always in tension with narrowism. There is no social or moral value. Now the man is behaving like an animal. Animality can be changed with moral education. Education teaches values like cooperation, tolerance, sympathy, fellow feelings, love, affection, respect towards elder, helping the poor and needy persons. Providing opportunity or equality is another criterion. That is, Indian education has introduced the term equality. Education teaches to give equal opportunities in all respects, irrespective of caste, creed, color, sex, and religion. Inculcation of civic and social responsibility is the next criteria. Education trains an individual to be competent and inculcate in him civic responsibility by making him aware of his rights and duties as citizen of a democratic country. The next is capacity for research and innovation. That is, through education we get a chance to know what is happening around the world and adapt to new situations and changes. The need for new requirements will definitely lead to research and innovation. As it says, necessity is the mother of invention. The next is training for leadership. The leadership quality of the individual is developed when they participate in all spheres of social, political, religious, and educational activities. National integration. It is the binding force that unites the citizen of a country. The national integration will help to create the feeling of oneness among its people, even though they may differ in color, caste, language, diet, dress habits, and physical environment. Now let us see the various aspects of human development, which is often regarded as the pillars of human development. There are six basic pillars of human development. Let us see what they are. First one, equity, sustainability, productivity, empowerment, cooperation, and security. Let us have a look into the equity concept. Equity is the idea of fairness for every person between men and women. Second, sustainability is a view that we all have the right to earn a living that can sustain our lives and have access to a more even distribution of goods. Third one, productivity states the full participation of people in the process of income generation. This also means that the government needs more efficient social programs for its people. Fourth one, empowerment is the freedom of the people to influence development and decisions that affect their lives. Fifth one, cooperation stipulates participation and belonging to community and groups as a means of mutual enrichment and a source of social meaning. And finally, security offers people development opportunities freely and safely with confidence that they will not disappear suddenly in the future. Now let us have a look into the components of human development. That is, the noted Pakistani economist Mahbubul Haq considered the four essential pillars of human development. Let us see what they are. These are equality, sustainability, productivity, and empowerment. Let us have a look into the equality concept. If development is viewed in terms of enhancing people's basic capabilities, people must enjoy equitable access to opportunities. Such may be called equality-related capabilities. To ensure equality-related capabilities or access to opportunities, what is essential is that the societal institutional structure needs to be more favorable or progressive. Further, to ensure basic equality, political opportunities need to be more equal. In the absence of effective political organization, disadvantaged groups are exploited by the rich to further their own interests rather than social goals. The second aspect is the sustainability. That is another important facet of human development is that human development should keep going. That means it should last long. The concept of sustainable development focuses on the need to maintain the long-term protective capacity of the biosphere. In 1987, the Bratland Commission report, that is named after the then Prime Minister Gro Harlem Brundtland of Norway, defined sustainable development as development that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of the future generations to meet their basic needs. This means that the term sustainability focuses on the desired balance between future economic growth and environmental quality. To attain the goal of sustainable development, what is of great importance is the attainment of the goal of both intra-generation and inter-generation equality. The third aspect is that of productivity. That is another component of human development, which requires investment in people. This is commonly called investment in human capital. Investment in human capital, in addition to physical capital, can add more productivity. And finally, the empowerment. The empowerment of people, particularly women, is another component of human development. Empowerment implies a political democracy in which people themselves make the decision about their lives. Under it, people enjoy greater political and civil liberties and remain free from excessive controls and regulation. Empowerment refers to decentralization of power so that the benefit of governance are reaped by all peoples. From this, you can see that human development is closely associated with economic growth. Human development is a broad and comprehensive concept. It is as much concerned with economic growth as with distribution, as with basic human needs, and with variety of human aspirations, as with the distress of rich countries, as with human deprivation of the poor. Economic growth is linked with human development. Economic growth is important because no society has been able to sustain the well-being of its people without continuous growth. So, it is seen that economic growth is essential for human development. But human development is equally important because it is healthy and educated people who contribute more to economic growth through productive employment and increase in income. Thus, human development and economic growth are closely connected. In reality, economic growth is a means to an end, and the end is human development. Policymakers should therefore pay more attention to the quality of growth so as to support all-round human development. Let us see the relationship in detail. Human development and economic growth are closely related. It is said that there exists a two-way relationship between the two. The first chain, consisting of economic growth benefiting from human development with gross national product. Specifically, gross national product increases human development by expenditure from families, government and organizations such as non-government organizations, NGOs. With the rise in economic growth, families and individuals will likely increase expenditure with heightened incomes, which in turn leads to growth in human development. Further, with the increased consumption, health and education factor also contributes to economic growth. In addition to increasing private incomes, economic growth also generates additional resources that can be used to improve social services, that is healthcare, safe drinking water, etc. By generating additional resources for social services, unequal income distribution will be mitigated. As such, social services are distributed equally across each community, thereby benefiting each individual, thus increasing the living standards for the public. Consequently, the relation between human development and economic growth can be explained in three ways. First, increase in average income leads to improvement in health and nutrition, known as capability expansion through economic growth. Second, it is believed that the social outcomes can only be improved by reducing income poverty, known as capability expansion through poverty reduction. Lastly, social outcomes can be improved with essential services such as education, healthcare, and clean drinking water, known as capability expansion through social services. Now, we will move on to the concept of Human Development Report. The Human Development Report, commonly referred as HDR, is released by the United Nations and contains the Human Development Index. The Human Development Report indexes include, first, Human Development Index, Gender-Related Development Index, Gender Empowerment Measure, Human Poverty Index. Just look into the Human Development Index. It is an improved standard means of measuring well-being, especially child welfare, and thus human development. Human development is measured with the Human Development Index. The Human Development Index, that is HDI, is a normalized measure of life expectancy, education and per capita income for countries worldwide. Thus, the HDI is a composite of three social indicators, that is life expectancy, adult literacy and years of schooling, and finally, it also takes into account real GDP per capita. Of three fundamental dimensions, living a long and healthy life, being educated and having decent standard of living, the HDI value of a country is calculated by three indicators, that is longevity as measured by life expectancy at birth, educational attainment as measured by a combination of adult literacy, that is 2/3 weight is given, and combined primary, secondary and tertiary enrollment ratio, that is 1/3 ratio is given to it. And lastly, the decent standard of living as measured by real GDP per capita based on purchasing power parity in terms of dollar. Before the HDI is calculated, an index is created for each of these dimensions, life expectancy index, education index and GDP index. To calculate these indices, minimum and maximum value of goalposts are chosen for each indicator. Usually, the dimension index is calculated by subtracting the minimum value from the actual value, which is divided by a sum obtained after the minimum value is subtracted from the maximum value. The HDI is then calculated as a simple average of these three dimension indices. Human Poverty Index. In order to reflect the gaps in the Human Development Index, the United Nations came out with the Human Poverty Index, that is referred as HPI in the year 1997. The HPI measures the deficiencies in the three indices of the Human Development Index: long and healthy life, knowledge, and a decent standard of living. Then comes the Gender Development Index. The Gender Development Index, that is referred as GDI, is often considered as a gender sensitive extension of the HDI. It addresses gender gaps in life expectancy, education, and incomes. It uses an inequality evasion penalty, which creates a development score penalty for gender gaps in any of the categories of the Human Development Index, which include life expectancy, adult literacy, school enrollment, and logarithmic transformation of per capita income. The final component is the gender empowerment measure. The gender empowerment measure, that is referred as GEM, is an index designed to measure of gender equality. GEM is the United Nations Development Programme's attempt to measure the extent of gender inequality across the globe's countries, based on estimate of women's relative economic income, participation in higher paying positions with economic power, and access to professional and parliamentary positions. It was introduced at the same time as the Gender-Related Development Index, that is GDI, but measures topics like empowerment that are not covered by that index. We shall pass on to the need for human development and education. It leads to the individual development of an individual, as we all know. It helps to contribute prospective citizens to the society. Then it helps people to understand the importance of maintaining small family norms. Then again, it helps people to understand about the basic indicator of human development. Not at all that, it helps them to understand the theory of demographic transition, and this applies it in their daily life. Again, it helps individual to understand the trend of various human development indices during the previous decade. It can contribute for the development of the economy. Again, vocational development of individuals are made possible through it. It helps them to understand about the basic components such as equality, productivity, sustainability, and empowerment. Human development is possible through education. Education plays a very important role in molding the character of an individual. It is one of the concrete sources from which one can get information and knowledge. A well-developed individual is an asset to the society. This is because he or she can contribute to the development of the society in many ways. Hence, education plays an important role in societal development. The major role lies in preservation, transmission of cultural and moral values. That is, through education curriculum, students will be acquainted with social, moral, and cultural values, and teachers make them familiar with values and ideals through different activities like games, storytelling, etc. Then there is the possibility for awakening of social feelings. Through education, individuals become aware about the importance of unity, love, fraternity, and other values. Education makes all people get awakened of being a part of society and how they can contribute to the world as society. People know different values and life skills, and thus they develop concern for society, including social mindedness, values, life skills, learning to be, learning to do, learning to know, learning to live together via different activities, storytelling, dramatization, etc. Then there happens the political development of the society. How? Education makes all aware about rights and duties of all, which are their responsibilities and duties, so they can develop their civic sense. Through different lessons of political leaders and stories, education develops ideal leadership quality so that in future citizens can lead the state as a society. Then there is possibility for economic development. Education develops skills in individual and makes him a productive citizen. Through education, everyone learns how to earn money, and as per their qualification, he gets job or labor, and on the whole, the help of education, more or less everyone get work and earn money. So due to increasing literacy, per capita income will increase as we find government takes help in the form of TADs and thus our economy develops. Because of education, people migrate in other countries and their earning helps to develop society and the country's development. Thus, education affects the economic development of the society. Social control. Education makes all aware about customs and duties as it makes them aware about the rules and regulations of the constitution. People know how to preserve their lives via education. They also are familiar with crimes. This education provides a guideline and it controls all society. The next is social changes and reforms. Education makes individual perfect and aware about their rights. So they can claim against dual superstitions, beliefs which are harmful for them. Through education, everyone learn how to live and how to save from difficulty and how to inculcate values and ideals in their lives so that they can appeal in the court having a feeling injustice. Education makes all aware about how to live peacefully and how to face difficulties in their lives. They become aware about the proverbs like nothing ventured, nothing gained. So they develop their risk-taking attitudes via education. Then there is a socialization. Education trains the mind of a child and it teaches him how to inculcate values in his life. It makes the child understand what is society, how he is a part of society, what are his roles in society, how he should behave, how he should interact with others, etc. Education helps him to understand who is he, and it develops a sense of social being in him. In short, education socializes a child. Then finally, moving on to the role of education in national development. Modern and ancient philosophers have supported the notion of national development and advocated that education is most powerful force in developing national development, that is through human resource development, emotional integration, technological advancement, technical education, fostering positive attitude, employment, job-oriented education by removing illiteracy, educated elite, national outlook, inculcate cooperative responsibility, practical use of knowledge, strengthen democratic principles, acquaintance with one's talents and virtues. So, dear students, have a look into the summary of this module. We have discussed about the concept of human development. Hope you might have understood the pillars of human development. What kind of relation exists between human development and economic growth? How individual development leads to societal development and transform the nation, and also the different components of human development report. Now you may understand the significance of the statement made by Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, the destiny of India is being shaped in her classroom. Let us join together for a better nation. So empower ourselves, empower our nation. Thank you.